Hi, this is Kay. Thank you for checking out today's podcast of Hanging with the Hayters. We want to give special thanks to our sponsor, Sunny Horn, with Leaders Financial Group. You can give them a call at 832-381-2515.
You are listening to Hanging with the Hayters. Thank you so much for showing up. This is Mark Hayter, and across from me is my lovely and darling wife, Kay. You know, Kay, we haven't even hardly seen each other in passing this morning. I've been up and struggling and... Yeah, that's to be expected, Kay, because you know something? We go to bed very late. Folks, I don't know if you do, but I cannot, I usually don't go to bed before 1 o'clock. And, that's exactly it, Kay. And yet, yeah, I still get up early, but I take a nap. That's really good. By the way, Kay, I would like to say a special shout-out to Sunny Horn, Leaders Financial Group, our sponsor. And, by the way, it's second Monday that is... We get some financial information about what the market's doing and all. So tune into, make sure you tune into that. And right now you're tuning in to
retirement advisor, but he is also our friend.
Hold it. We're having.
Yes.
Sorry. Hey,
my mic
better
wasn't
now,
on.
Kay.
Yeah.
When your mic's on, my mic seems to be on good too. Anyway, okay. Folks, that was just so much stuff. So, and speaking of so much stuff, Kay, there is a lot of stuff out there. We've got two special guests, Lisa Hightower, who is one of the founders and promoters of the Pet Parade, which is this Tuesday, ladies and gentlemen, at the fairgrounds.
At the Montgomery County Fair.
County Fair grounds. The rodeo should be over by then, and there's, by the way,
the Houston Rodeo, anyway.
Well,
so.
Yeah, what I mean, at the fairgrounds, I believe they have the rodeo and all, but I think the rodeo's over before, I think the rodeo ends this weekend, by Sunday it's over, but they're still having the shows, the cows, and all of these
things.
Oh,
I see, the rodeo yeah. part.
And one of the shows is the pet parade, ladies and gentlemen, and it is eerie fascinating. It is, you got your little kids 8 and under bringing their pets across, and it's not just dogs.
And being judged. On things like, you know, behavior and if they know any tricks and
yeah,
how
and
much.
Then what the pets can do. The
right,
pets
how much
tricks.
The child knows about their pet,
yeah,
that kind of thing. So,
anyway, it's fascinating.
I think we've had some borrowed pets in the past.
We have, Kay. I've caught it right off. Me and Big Al will be emceeing, and that's my kid brother. And a lot of times, I mean, we have to interview them to see, you know, they're being judged on their poise and all. And not poison, but their poise. And all, and you know, it's nice if they know what they feed their dog or what their dog's name is. That helps.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Anyway, but there's other things going on. And Dick, I just found out last night. I went to a meeting to find out what I am emceeing at the Rising Stars Legend of Texas, which the part that involves. It's April the 22nd. I don't know what's happening before or after that, but the 22nd. And Dick, that's when I found out that I was involved with you at the Owens Theater, that you're doing radio stuff and broadcast there.
Yeah, we haven't really released the details yet, but we're doing Laundry and Bourbon, the one-act play, and we're going to be doing that on the stage.
Okay.
For during the festival, April 22nd, downtown Conroe, yay, for representing the Players Theater Company.
All right.
So, and then I think the kids' organization's doing Armadillo Chili, which is another, I don't know if Don's released the whole schedule yet, but if people don't know what the Rising Stars of Texas is, it is a whole artist theater collaboration in the Conroe Arts area downtown, and it's an all-day event. There's different organizations doing something artistic, entertainment mm-hmm. kind of thing, and the Players Theater Company at the Owen Theater is putting on two radio plays, one with the kids, I think that's earlier in the morning, and then one later in the evening with the adults with Laundry and Bourbon. So.
And you know, Dick, I have every confidence that in 15 years this will be known as South by Southeast, because it'll be big.
Well, yeah, there's one music act, I guess, to compare it, but it's more on the arts.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah. It's if you're into art and you want to see some interesting people and experience some interesting things, April 22nd.
Well, it does sound really cool, so I hope there'll be a good
turnout.
The Don's
working really hard on it, and all the organizations involved have been doing something really cool. So, Yeah.
I tell you, these volunteers who get together to organize stuff, like Don Hampton, the stuff he's got to go through for sponsors and lining up everything is unbelievable. Dick's been involved in many things like this. And, of course, we've got Lisa Hightower and Lou Robinson coming, and they sponsor this thing, get it all together, the pet parade.
Yes.
But anyway, and one other thing that's been got together, Kay, that I really like is, of course, this is Wednesday's Courier, not Sunday's Courier, which, Kay, I will be, my article, which I don't know what it's going to be about yet, but it'll be in Sunday's. And anyway, I was looking in Wednesday's and Sunday's, they have a back in history time, just like the Houston Chronicle does. So Hearst owns the Courier and the Villager, and they have a little segment in here about the Montgomery County Fair way back when. And I just wanted to bring your attention to it because it mentioned several things. I see a couple of pictures in here, one of which is the Red Duke, Kay, in 1980. Might have been several times in 1980. You know Red Duke, Dr. Red Duke.
Yes, I do. I remember him very well. Yes, he's the one that set up the life light at the big Herman Hospital and the medical center.
And Craig
Capanello?
Capanello, thank you. Has done a bust, I haven't seen it yet, of Red Duke, the ex, I mean, he's passed away, but Red Duke, what a great guy.
He was,
And he was judging the rib contest, and there's a picture, and not only that, ladies and gentlemen, I saw this deal. They show you the history of stuff, and they mentioned in 1984 that the population of the Woodlands in 1984, which was James Orwell's, George Orwell's book, 1984, which didn't come to true, but we're, I don't know what we are. Anyway, there the population was 18,500 K in 1984.
The Woodlands.
Today, ladies and gentlemen, the Woodlands population is 112,505. That's like more. It has grown like a lot more over a period of, since 84 is 16 plus 17 is 33, something like that years. And I just did that math in my head. And I'm sure it's wrong. Anyway, that was fascinating. Folks, get the Courier and look at these pictures and read something about the past and read. There is one of the giant, the longest letters to the editor. Water wars the truth. It is so long and water is so important.
I like to have water.
And I'm not
going to
read that because it's too long. Okay? It's kind of like my articles. They're too long a lot. I'm going to try to cut those down. I don't know if it's possible. Anyway, those are a couple of fascinating stories. I did want to keep people abreast, okay, on some of the laws that have been introduced.
Yes, our legislature is in session.
It is.
The state legislature.
Yeah. And I mentioned,
I'm not sure what the federal one's doing.
Yeah, that's true. They're supposed to be there, but I don't, we don't know what they're doing.
Who knows?
But anyway, there were, here's some of the bills that have been introduced. They, not all of these have been passed yet. I don't think there'll be much trouble except for one that I'll be mentioning in a minute. One is legalized, they're legalizing fantasy sports. I didn't know they were illegal, and I don't know how you illegalize fantasy sports, but, you know, it's where you have a football.
Fantasy football
league.
Dick,
you do that, don't you? Do you participate in the fantasy football stuff?
Yes, I do.
All right. And you do you, well, the team in the future you don't have yet for 19.
No, it's like a draft. So when they announce, I guess when the NFL completes their official roster of their 55 guy or whatever, I don't know what the exact number is, but that's when it starts.
Man. And K, they even have ways to rate, I understand now, the offensive line. You get points. That's, I've read an article about
it. There's so many ways you can set up a game inside the fantasy league. But typically for offensive lines, that's not an option. So, like, you basically pick an individual player. And then, like, the one I'm in, we just pick a whole defense. You don't pick an individual defensive player. You just pick a whole defense.
That makes so much more sense.
So you can make it real simple or you can make it really complicated depending on – but how you like to play.
The group you're with doesn't have the same. None of them can have the same offensive or defensive
Well, it's like a draft. We have a draft. So whoever selects that, no one else can select that for the position wise.
Well, that makes perfect sense. By the way, one thing that didn't take a law, Kay, and I might have mentioned this several weeks ago, but who remembers? Raise your hand out there if you remember this I mentioned. In baseball this year, professional baseball, they don't have to throw four pitches to walk a guy, intentionally walk a person. You know, normally it's where the catcher steps out of the box and the pitcher throws it to him.
Right.
And it takes up four pitches. He's got to do that. And, you know, there may be someone on base, so he's still got to go through the motion.
It's taking time.
Now all he has to do is give a signal, that he's walking the guy, and all the guy has to do, Kay, is walk to first base. Isn't that fascinating? To cut down the time.
Sounds good to me.
I heard an old story. In fact, I read it, and it's one of those things, Kay, that I think is a story. I can't believe it's the truth. Casey Stengel was managing the Yankees, and I forget who was coming up. It was, I think, someone from Boston. It could have been Detroit, but, Kay, really, who cares? And he wanted to walk him, and Casey made the signal to walk him. So the catcher puts his glove out here, and the pitcher winds up and throws a strike. And the guy thought, "Wow, I'm being walked, and it's a strike, son of a gun!" And Casey Stengel gets out of the dugout and starts yelling at the guy and cussing the pitcher, "Walk him!" And the pitcher nods like that. The guy winds up and throws again and throws a strike, and Casey comes out and gets on the mound and starts kicking the dirt and all. Pulled the pitcher out, brought another one in, and the pitcher threw, did the same thing. You're going to walk him, and the pitcher threw a strike, three strikes, and struck the guy out. Simply because they did not have that law where you can point to the umpire and walk the guy. But I don't think that really ever happened. I thought that was made up, but because no batter is that stupid,
It's a good story.
Okay, it's a beautiful story. Now, here's another law. You cannot, they're going to pass a law. Ladies and gentlemen, they're going to talk about a law in Texas.
They've written a bill.
This is not Congress. Where you cannot poison feral hogs. And when I read that, I was thinking, oh, my gosh, we've got so many feral hogs. We've got to do something with
them. Yeah, we do. But there is a problem.
The deal is when you poison them, they do say they've got a poison that will only kill hogs. I don't believe that.
Yeah.
To save my
butt.
But anyway, they're saying, that's good. We need to get rid of them. And that's not the way to do it, but I don't know.
Well, you think about, the things that eat the carcass of the hog. I mean, you're going to have dead vultures, and then who's going to clean that up?
Yeah. And, some of the people who were upset with it are the people, and there are industries out there where they are actually trapping, killing these hogs for food.
For food
because
pantries?
It's a delicacy in some places, take China or Japan. I don't know where. I'm sure they eat in the United States, too. But they're doing that, and they said, if you start poisoning them, we could be spreading this, whatever. Anyway, so that's something the Texas legislature is looking at.
I support that.
And here's one other. I know you realize they're limiting the ability of women to who wish to postpone the, decide that they don't want to hoist. They want an abortion. I start to say they don't want to host an impregnated embryo for 9 months. And so they're trying to stop that by, limiting abortion clinics and all. And, and that's what they're doing. Well, someone in the state legislature, some lady has said, if we're going to do that to women, plus make them have a cervical test where they actually do x-rays and all before you can have an abortion, another way, put them through another strenuous problem, which is one of the most difficult concepts. People don't agree on this and all, but this lady did this. She said, here's what we're going to do. We are going, she's trying to pass a bill that says we are going to increase create a wait period for men who prescribe to Viagra. 24 hours now. You can get the prescription, but you got to wait 24 hours to get it, and the reason being to preserve the sanctity of life, so that people will not have sex for the joy of having sex, because we're supposed to have sex for procreation. This is satire, folks. That's why she's doing that. And she's also prescribed that there will be a rectal examination for every male who prescribes, who wants to get Viagra. This bill's not going to pass. This lady's trying to make a point. You're doing this
she's
to women.
Trying to make a point here.
And men are the other side, and they're not. Anyway, fascinating stuff about the state legislature, stuff that I should have gone past. Speaking of going past, Kay, right about now is, I think, I don't see my clock, but we need to have a break. Our first break, ladies and gentlemen, we're coming back in a little bit with some news about Jordan Lee.
Hello, I'm Sonny Horn with Leaders Financial Group. For 25 years, Leaders has developed a working relationship with each of our clients that aid us in providing them opportunities to retire sooner than they likely thought possible. Our success is attributed largely to our thoroughness in drawing up a workable financial plan for each client. Saving money is tough for most, so we all need to receive the best long-term results possible for our efforts. Leaders Financial Group has earned a reputation for providing greater peace of mind for those who too often feel they're hoping against hope in what seems to be a most complicated financial market. Our goal at Leaders is to provide a keen sense of hope and financial security for those who come to us seeking direction. Process is simple. Phone call even more so. I'm Sonny Horn. Give me a call at 832-381-2515 and we'll help you establish a financial future that'll be ready when you're ready to retire.
And I'm Mark Hayter. One of the clients at Sonny Horn has helped retire sooner than I thought possible. It's our trust in him that led Kay and I to choose Leaders Financial Group as our sponsor.
And thank you for hanging with the Hayters this afternoon. Mark was just talking about, we were going to come back and talk about Jordan Lee. Who is Jordan Lee?
I was oblivious to this man's name until last weekend when I discovered that he is the world champion bass fisherman. Not the, state champion.
The world champion?
World champion, because he caught the most, the bass that weighed the most, not the one bass, but I don't know how many you're allowed
in total catch or something.
Yeah, in Lake Conroe. And I read that and I said, holy cow, you mean you can catch, be the best bass fisherman in Lake Conroe and end up being the best in the world?
Wow.
And anyway, he got some money in it. I mean, it's not as much as a golfer's going to get, but when it comes to being able to sponsor, for sponsors to give him money to say their rod and reel's the best or whatever. I've never been to one. Dick, have you ever been to one of those bass tournaments? And I'm sorry to...
No, I write about them.
Oh, that's neither here nor there. But, you know, I've just seen on TV, I haven't seen the Conroe one, but they say when they blow the whistle or whatever, boom! I mean, they are out. They don't want you to follow, you know, some bass guys want to follow other people. I don't know if that's how they do it or what, but, oh my gosh, you're out there fishing, and if...
I can't imagine being that good a fisherman, because, you know, when I get in a boat, fish flee.
Yeah, they flee fish.
Yeah.
And I don't know, I'm assuming they regulate with regard to if you've got some kind of sonar device or whatever, maybe they don't. But if I had one of those, what you call your drones, I would be following some fisherman, you know, say, okay, he's over there, that's a good spot. I mean, if I'm not entered into the contest, so I'll realize next week I'm going here because that's where he caught all those things. Wow, okay,
yeah,
fascinating. Those,
yeah.
Anyway,
we're not buying a drone, babe.
Jordan Lee, congratulations. I don't even know where you're from, but world greatest bass fisherman. And he was holding up, not the fish, he probably had that in another picture, but this trophy, and it was magnificent. It was huge. I don't know where he's going
to
put it.
You know, it would be fun to go out with a fishing guide sometime that knows the places and knows what bait works. Because I like to fish, but only if I'm actually catching something.
That's true, Kay. We've been on some bad...
Wasted. Well, bring a good book.
You know, deep water fishing, what are they called? Not deep water, it's...
Salt water fishing?
Yeah. You know, I am getting so upset today, I cannot come up with the words. Hey, I want to go deep sea fishing. Thank you so much, Kay.
Yes.
Anyway, I wouldn't want to go with a guide or otherwise. I could just see me, and I've heard stories of people out there getting... Anyway, a couple of other things going on, news. That was one about Jordan Lee. The other thing is that Girl Scout cookies, people have been stealing... from Girl Scouts, not their cookies, but their metal box that they keep their money in. They will. There's a rash of that, I'm thinking, because it's Girl Scout cookie time to sell.
Yes, it is.
Some guys just,
it is.
They say, you know, in a store or everywhere outside the store, you know, it's easy to, you know, someone
generally
comes up and distracts. Another person, just grabs a box and walks
off. Isn't
that
pitiful?
It is. Girls, be on your lookout. Actually, mothers. Mothers are in this big time, just like in this pet parade we're going
to
have.
Well, they need to be.
They need to be. And there, but, you know, some of them go to work and sell their cookies and all, and that's really wonderful. There was never a school year I didn't have to buy it. And once again, the mints, the thin mints, that's what we get. Reminds me of the gangster.
I don't think there's one out there I don't like.
Care occasionally on our show, Tony Thin Mints. Anyway, that was one of the other stories. And, Kate, this is... fascinating. I did not believe. You know, there is a coin, the world's largest coin.
I read about that.
You did.
The world's largest coin and gold coin.
That's it. It's the gold coin. It is 221 pounds of gold. It's a Canadian coin 220 pounds. If I'm, I think it's 18 inches might be. I think it's 18 inches around and an inch thick because gold is pretty heavy. And when they made it in 2007, it was $1 million coin. The price, the value of gold has gone up considerably to today. If you had a $1 million coin, it would be 55 pounds. In other words, in 2007, it was 221
wow.
pounds. Today,
yeah.
it would be 51.
Yeah.
But after saying that, it was stolen. It was on display in Berlin. And some bodies, because I don't think it could be more than one, went into this place that had all the, the devices that protect things. Another example, alarms.
They got through the security
system.
They
got through the security and hauled off a 221-pound chunk of gold. That is probably already melted down because, you stole the coin. No, I didn't. Yeah.
Well, they obviously, didn't stick it down their pants
no,
or anything
didn't.
Like that.
Not this
they
time.
Had to come with,
well,
with a satchel or something.
As it turns out, okay, they did have this video of a clown, a big baggy pant clown that had a massive limp and that was leaving the place, and I just made that up.
Oh.
But that's the only thing I could think of that would, anyway, that, and I'm going to tell you also, okay, and ladies and gentlemen, I don't know where else you're going to hear stuff like this. And I'm not talking about the train that's in the background coming. That's something
that's
different.
That's the country and commerce.
Yeah.
We're moving goods.
This is about France, the Eiffel Tower. And I learned something recently that I had never known. And if I had ever known it, I wouldn't have learned it because I already knew it. But Kay.
okay. You can't
wait,
say
Mark,
that again,
cut it
can
out.
You?
Yeah. You know, if you want to take, it's outlawed. It's against the law to take a picture of the Eiffel Tower at night. It has been since 1985.
And what's the reasoning on that?
Because in 1985, this artist was commissioned to put up the lights that are there now. It was a special deal, and he copyrighted it. He said, "This is my display, and you don't take a picture of it unless, you pay me money." After telling you that, it's been outlawed since 1985. No one has ever been charged. In other words, the French said, okay, yeah, sure, well, you've got a copyright, and they don't enforce it.
Oh, okay.
But I just want you to know.
Because I was going to say, that just doesn't sound right.
I just wanted you to know you're breaking the law if you take a picture of the Eiffel Tower at night. Mm. Anyway, that's another one of those.
Well, the next time we go to Paris, we'll be aware.
Yeah. Oh, okay. I don't want to go. It's because of the people. There's too many people, and most of them are French, but a lot of them are very nice, nicer than
okay,
a lot
honey,
of Texans
you need,
I know.
You need to move on.
I'm in so deep, dude.
Yes, you are.
It's,
yes,
scary.
You are.
Anyway, I just want to share that with you. There's other fascinating things. One thing is that this weekend is your last chance to see the Three Musketeers at the Owens Theater. Rick Sellers just did a PSA and a promotion for, his
PSA's
show.
Public service announcement.
Okay, this wasn't public. This was Rick's thing, I think.
Okay.
But anyway, great actor. He's playing Cardinal Richelieu, and I was reading Peggy Miller's review of the play, and she really enjoyed it, and she said it's unlike anything you've seen. It's not a musical, even though they have a choir singing what's going on, kind of comedic, she said, which I did. Anyway, that makes me want to see it.
Okay.
And she said, it's not... Well, she said she just laughed at it because the way they're handling the thing, and I haven't seen it, but I intend to.
I understand they had somebody that came in and actually taught them how to do this
wordplay.
Yes,
your choreography.
Yeah.
And I've been watching this thing, and I've mentioned it before on Netflix, that is one of the best choreographed karate fighting people I've ever seen. And in a lot of their fighting, they have two swords each. Do you know how hard it is, Kay, to choreograph two guys fighting, each with two swords? It's a lot of trouble, and they fight, and I don't know the name of the show. Oh, it's Into the Badlands or Out of the Badlands,
okay.
One of those things. Fascinating. Anyway, that was great. We got other things. I read this morning something a friend of mine sent. His name is Ray, and he sent me something about all of the sinkholes that are going on, and at the beginning of this thing he showed me, it's about 6 minutes worth of sinkholes, videos of sinkholes while they're happening all over the world.
Wow.
In China has the most anywhere.
Is that right?
And what's scary, not scary, but weird, is China's actually being able to videotape them. And it shows this lady walking down the street and the ground just opens up, a small place big enough for her to fall through.
Wow.
In China. And then they showed other things. I don't know. By the way, that's the cuckoo clock, and we're ignoring that son of gun. Anyway, and they're all over the place. And I saw this video, and then they explain why there are so many sinkholes. And I thought it was going to be a joke, but they're serious. That lately the sun has been creating tremendous amount of electrical energy. They've had sunspots and all this kind of stuff, explosions. And every time they do, it sends off electrical impulses out towards Earth. We're getting bombarded. And by the way, right. They're saying one day, it may be tomorrow, it may be in 30 minutes, there is going to be an explosion on the sun, not to destroy the sun, but it's going to destroy every electrical device, supposedly.
Yeah, if the storm blows at the right time and angle.
Our satellites
will be
gone.
And we're in the direct path,
Exactly. It's got to hit us. And it may have done it before, but it was a time during we didn't have a bunch of electricity going on in this country. Anyway.
So then we're going to dig out all our mom and dad's old vacuum tube radios and
exactly.
whatever?
That's what the Russians did with their fighter jets. We captured one of their MiG-23, and they had old vacuum tubes in it. We thought, you idiots, you're so far behind us, it's unbelievable. And then the scientists said, no, they're pretty sharp, because they realize if there's a nuclear war, our jets don't have the
or on the ground
tubes,
or
and theirs will still be flying.
Yeah.
But folks, that has nothing to do with these sinkholes. Do you see how Kay gets me off of topic so often? No. What it is, they say, it's changing the electrical impulse from the center of the Earth, from the core where you've got your molten metal.
Yeah.
It's got the negative charge, they say, and up above, this is an example, and up above in the atmosphere, what's happening is when these things hit, the positive charges are staying in the above, and what it's causing is an impulse that's creating cavities in the crust of the Earth. And as it does, there's more sinkholes develop as a result.
This is a theory. Right?
Oh, it's a theory like all get out,
big
but they're
time.
Saying it like
right.
it's true. And here's what they say is causing a lot of it. They say when the sun does that, it slows down the rotation. First, it speeds up the rotation of the Earth, and then it slows it down. Let me tell you this. If that is happening, it is a nanosecond it's slowing down. It's negligible if that does happen.
Right. Unnoticeable.
Unnoticeable, because you would definitely, oh my gosh, ladies and gentlemen, today the Earth, the day is 5 minutes shorter than it was before because the Earth's spinning faster. No, that doesn't happen. Fascinating stuff. And Kay, I've got to mention something else. There's so many science news stories and all, and you like fish, don't you, Kay?
I do. I like to eat them. I like to look at them.
Yeah, you want to have what you call your
aquarium.
And that's another thing I had trouble coming up with. And you know, right now, okay, I'm getting a sensation in my pants. My phone is buzzing. I don't understand how that happens, but normally I don't have it with me, and I don't feel the sensation, but it's pretty exciting. Anyway, earthquakes are on the move, they say now, because one of the indicators is out there, ladies and gentlemen. And what it is the oarfish, the O-A-R fish. I had no idea there was such a thing, Kay, but there is something called an oarfish, and there are more and more of them coming around the Philippines. And these are, they're deep-sea fish that aren't supposed to be this shallow, and some of them are 600 pounds, but they're showing up
out there.
And they
live in the depths.
They live in the depths. Some people say, no, it's, water temperature changing, and a lot of other people said, no, that is an indication. We've seen this before when earthquakes hit. Don't know when.
You know, there's been other times when people said that before an earthquake that animals were doing weird things.
Right.
You know, the horses were running or the...
Yeah. Birds were flying backwards. That kind of thing that is very rare. Okay, I made that one up too.
Yeah.
Anyway, fascinating. But oarfish and something else is happening, ladies and gentlemen. The ocean, the oxygen level in the ocean is 2% less than it has been in the past, and that's a sign of course, the ocean's warming. Ladies and gentlemen, fascinating, but you want to know what's fascinating. When we come back, ladies and gentlemen, in a couple of minutes, we're going to have Lisa Hightower and none other than Lou Robinson talk to us about the pet parade.
Hello, I'm Sonny Horn with Leaders Financial Group. For 25 years, Leaders has developed a working relationship with each of our clients that aid us in providing them opportunities to retire sooner than they likely thought possible. Our success is attributed largely to our thoroughness in drawing up a workable financial plan for each client. Saving money is tough for most, so we all need to receive the best long-term results possible for our efforts. Leaders Financial Group has earned a reputation for providing greater peace of mind for those who too often feel they're hoping against hope in what seems to be a most complicated financial market. Our goal at Leaders is to provide a keen sense of hope and financial security for those who come to us seeking direction. Process is simple. Phone call even more so. I'm Sonny Horn. Give me a call at 832-381-2515 and we'll help you establish a financial future that'll be ready when you're ready to retire.
And I'm Mark Hayter, one of the clients that Sonny Horn has helped retire sooner than I thought possible. It's our trust in him that led Kay and I to choose Leaders Financial Group as our sponsor.
Staying with us after those fascinating stories, I could just hear people bailing on me. But now's a good time to be back because we do have a good friend of mine. Good friend. How many people? I mean, I see Lisa Hightower once every year, but she is so charming and nice. I like to think she's a good friend. She may not claim me. But that being said, she's with us, and so is someone I met her on her Facebook page, Lou Robinson, who is eerie fascinating also. But right now, I'd like to, I called him on particularly because of the pet parade, which is going to be at the fairgrounds, Montgomery County Fairgrounds on April 4th. I saw in the newspaper, Lisa, this morning, I think they did this last year too, they said it's listed as being at 5 o'clock.
Registration starts at 5.
Yeah.
And normally it's for the dogs because we tend to have more dogs than we have any other animal. But it's open. We've had fish and turtles and
wallaby.
Cats. And yes, we did have a wallaby.
Yeah. Last year they had a cow.
Yeah.
Yes, they brought a ponies.
The ponies, I like the little kid that rode the pony across.
Right. Now, Lisa, with the dogs or the cats, they have to bring and make sure they have the proof of their rabies. Is that the only thing, or do you have horse goggins and or anything else for the rules and the regulations for them to sign up?
Proof of rabies, goggins if you have it. And the other thing that was a big thing last year that people need to realize that once the judging is complete and the ribbons and everything have been handed out and the bags, prizes, the animals have to go back home and not to the carnival. So that was one of the big things last year.
Okay.
You know, and also, ladies and gentlemen, do not forget your coggins. They are, you'll have them in your back bed. What the Sam Hill is a coggin?
Let's talk about horses.
Okay. Oh my gosh, it's one of those things? Oh, it's proof of, what you call your sterilization or something?
It's the required proof of your negative coggins at registration. So all equines, all equines would have to have that.
Okay, if you're bringing an equine with you or riding an equine with you, have your coggins.
It's like a health certificate, I guess.
Yes.
Okay.
But
I'm pretty sure that it's the coggins and the rabies for the pet parade for a dog or a cat. But I don't think we don't require like an ick test for goldfish or anything like that. So.
No.
If you want to carry your goldfish bowl and dress him up, bring that down too.
That would be, in fact, we urge you to do that. And any non-dogs, love dogs, that Great Dane we had last year might have won.
He was beautiful.
That was a beautiful dog.
He was huge, white and black, just beautiful. And the kids, they come dressed up and the animal is dressed up and you know, it's a really great event.
I think it's great because I think they're so excited and everybody gets into it when they're walking and they have so many costumes and they interact with their pet and you can see so much of the family involvement and the community involvement in it. I just think it's a wonderful thing every year and I think it gets bigger and bigger. And it's one of the best things that I enjoy during the Montgomery County Fair time.
Wow, that's great. I definitely enjoy it, too, and I particularly like it better since they're getting their rabies shots. Make sure they do that. Big Al and I will be emceeing, and I don't know, Lisa, if you recall, but that pit bull, I actually let him take some beef jerky out of my mouth.
Cash.
Nice.
His name was Cash.
Dog.
Johnny
Cash. He was this. Lisa knows everything. Her kids. How many kids have been involved in it? Just the one? A rooster won it one year?
No. Cole and his rooster won it.
I remember that. Besides with the pet parade, you are on the committee and you deal a lot with the educational in the educational building too.
Yes. There is a building at the Montgomery County Fair that is agricultural education. And as you come in, you can see chicks hatching in the incubator. And then, you know, the chicks under the lights. We will have hens set up where they're laying in the boxes. They also will have four different types of sheep. They will also have a birthing pen. And each day, a lamb will be having a baby.
Whoa, I need to organize that.
Very carefully.
Yeah.
Very carefully.
That would be, yeah, I remember the chickens last time. Luke, let me ask you this. How can we tell the listeners where the Sam Hill, the pet parade is going to be with respect to the fairgrounds?
I'm not good at that.
I never have been. I went there one year. Me and Al, the announcers, and it was when they moved it from the building, and I went up to officials.
To the pavilion.
Parade, and I don't know. Yeah, okay. And my thought was, how does anybody find it?
But it will be in the exhibit tent. As you come through the front gates, it will be to the left. It's across from the rodeo arena.
That's exactly. The rodeo arena, and I remember it more because it used to be indoor football. What do they call it? Indoor
rugby?
No. This was real football. We used to have a team, the... in Conroe. They were pretty Tyrones. I don't know what the Tyrones. Anyway, and it's out there.
If you're local Conroe though, it changes. We've grown so huge for the Montgomery County Fair. I mean, I'm an alumni, so way back in the day, we're not going to talk about it, but I was one of them that used to show animals as a student there. And of course, we didn't have everything that's out there now. So when somebody says, where's it at? Kind of stops in your, it stops what you remember the best, which was years ago. And you're like, well, I don't know, because we just was under that big part and now it's got this building and it's confusing.
You know, that is one thing in today's Courier, in the history section, they actually have an aerial view of them whenever they started building the rodeo grounds and everything. You can see what, a work in progress. Well, now it's there, and it is better than so many counties, I'm assuming, because it is a very nice facility they have out there. Let me stress, any pet, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not big on snakes, but whatever you've got out there, as long as I don't have to touch it, or if it's a snake or something, bring it, and the more bizarro, the better. It's interesting. And your kid is what's very interesting, just if they can... Anyway, just show them up, and that's great.
And the pet parade is set for children that are 8 and under, and they bring their pets from home and actually get to show them and win trophies.
Right.
So, and the reason it is that the kids for only 8 and under is because at the age of 9, you can start showing in the non-livestock and livestock shows at the Montgomery County Fair. So we tried to design something for the children that are not able to show livestock.
Yeah, they may have an older brother or sister who is, and they feel like they're left out.
Well, it helps them, too, though. It helps them start integrating, and if they wanted to do something, or it helps them to say, how come I can't be a part? But they can, and they can do it with their pet that they have such a good bond with and be able to show them off and become a part, and everybody cheers them on as well.
Yeah. So, there will be plenty of ribbons and, of course, trophies. And one other thing I wanted to stress is about, it is a full-fledged showing of pets, but it's not official. We've got the judges, in other words, are not, my brother's judged before. And in other words, if you are watching there to see, oh my gosh, they didn't do this, or they didn't judge on this pet's particular breed
like,
or whatever,
it's not like that at all.
Westminster
Dog Show or anything.
No, it's not a professional show.
That was the word, Lisa, I'm looking for, young lady. And it's
she's good like that,
she
right?
Is so
she just
good.
Jumps in.
And the children are being looked at too. I mean, it's if you have a very shy child, and they do it, it you may not get as much points if this child can't tell me the name of the dog or whatever. But really, if, like you mentioned, Lisa, if the kid's dressed up in some, we've had Toto's there, and the little girl's dressed like.
Oh, I love the one that was the one year. Was it last year that she was like a mermaid? She had a mermaid, and she had her long hair.
Ooh, yeah.
And, she was so cute. Now, Lisa, there's no entry fee for this, right?
No entry fee. We just need you there about 5:30. Showing will begin at 6 o'clock.
Okay.
And no parking cost. during the week. And so there's no gate charge to get in, just as she mentioned, a fee to enter your pet. Anyway, great event, highly recommended.
And one of the things that we do at the end, and I know me as far as being WARE, which is Warriors Educate About Rescue, we are helping in providing a goodie bag to each child and their pet that is involved in the pet parade.
Right.
So I know you're gathering that up too, so hopefully you're going to have some other organizations that's going to be able to help out and get the things in those bags and pass those out. I know WARE's going to take part in that and try to help do our part and give something to the children and the kids and the pets too. So,
well, we've made sure that every child that brings a pet from home and shows them will walk away with a prize. And what it does is it gets these kids ready for livestock showing. So, you know, that's what we're all about. And
the When I think of this, I think of the organization, the organizers of it, and the amount of time. Like, just getting in touch with you, Lisa, is a major problem because, and I'm sure it is with you too, you're busy as a one of those
beaver
person. Yeah, one of those two. How do you even find time to enjoy yourself is one of the questions I have.
It's hard to say that because we grew up showing this. This has been a part of our life always.
Oh, ever.
Always. Know. And so we think about it and you just do it. It's fun.
Yeah.
By the time it all ends, you're like exhausted again. And then you're going, oh my God, I don't know if I can do this again. And then it rebuilds for the entire year because the community comes together so much. And even with all the hectic and bustle of it, it's almost like family, and then you make some life bonds. Lisa and I showed animals when we were in high school and younger than that. Lisa West, me and Lisa showed animals. I wish she was here right now. She couldn't be here. But and you remember all that, and that's some great memories to have.
It's like on the educational committee for the agricultural exhibit barn there. Mm-hmm. Two of the girls and my husband. We were all in FFA together, you know.
Yeah.
So we're on the same committee. We're pitching in. We're doing what our parents did and, you know, supporting our community.
Man.
I think one of the biggest things that I like to see since, you know, transitioning from a kid and a student and then showing and then to an adult and then being able to sponsor or organize is I like the way that it has grown because if you weren't showing an animal way back when, you didn't have a lot of you didn't have a lot of involvement, and now we have so much of the that you don't have to show an animal. You could do photographer and woodworking, and it's getting everybody involved. And so, even if you didn't have somebody in the family that was not showing an animal, they could be interested in something else.
Yeah.
And
we have art. And
oh, they have just
photography, yeah.
And
yeah.
I mean, and that's one of my favorite things, being Luar images. So, I think a lot of it's given the opportunity for the community and the county and a lot of other children to be involved and adults to be involved and bring in more into the actually fair itself. And it's phenomenal now, the things that are involved in doing the fair and how many different categories that there is.
You know, Lou, I'd like to talk about WARE, but before that, I'd like to talk about your photography and all. You mentioned images. Please tell us a little bit about
I'm a photographer. My company is Luar Images. I do standard photography, you know, things like most photographers, your engagement photos, your, you know, parents' photos, your couples' photos, your individual photos. But I got into photography and started doing, I do a lot of animal photography. And we do a lot of wall art. I do a lot of wall art. You can find a lot of my art in the veterinarian offices for their, like at 1488. And then I will be doing a show over here at Conroe Coffee on September 29th. I have a little Affenpinscher pug. And to bring light for, I'm always interested in education. So to bring light into education, we're going to be having the history of hats. And we have an Affenpinscher pug. Her name is Rita, and she's going to be wearing a series of different hats. These are big format prints to get people to understand where the bowler come from or where the newsboy cap came from and to just reaffirm that. And if you were interested in looking at something on the wall. So I did a lot of photography doing rescue animals to try to help them get adopted.
Right.
So, but it's kind of morphed. So that's that's one of the passions I have. And so, you know, if you're interested in having your picture taken, just look me up, Lou R. Images, and we'll be able to,
you know,
help you.
Lou, this could be a stretch, but I'm thinking that there's probably nowhere on the planet where someone else has the history of hats presentation or show using a dog.
With an affenpinscher pug?
Yeah. Say the first word. An
affenpinscher.
Affen. What does that mean?
She's an affenpinscher.
A?
A-F-F-I-N-S. And I'm slaughtering it. I don't know how to spell. I was graduated from Conroe. No, I'm just kidding.
thank you. I'm reading.
No, but that's the name. She's a mix, and she was a rescue. And that's our best guess, unless you do a DNA test, what she is. Yeah. She's not very big, but she's going to have an ascot, you know, the hats from the ascot or Kentucky Derby.
You got her well-trained if she will wear hats.
She's a diva when it comes to that. And I've had dogs before come through and some rescues that didn't like it, but she's just one of them that just took to it. I mean, she just took to it. So, and she loves it. And
that's September the
29th.
We'll have to have reminders about that.
Yeah.
Next door. Tell me about, I mean, I've seen on Facebook Zippy Tie.
Zip Tie.
Zip Tie. I am so sorry. Tell me, is she still alive?
He's still alive.
Okay, he's still alive.
He is still alive. He's still being his good old self.
How old is Zippy now?
He's eight.
Eight.
And how that started out is, you know, he started doing, going to, like, Texas Children's and different hospitals and seeing the kids.
A comfort dog.
Yes. Yeah. And I don't know, that was kind of the same time when Facebook was getting popular and all that. And then what happens is Zippy starts getting more friends than I got.
I noticed that. Zip is easier to get to than you are.
Yeah.
Yes.
And how come I don't? He could be aware. I mean, can he go into the schools with us at
yes.
war? At you never told me that.
That is.
So.
How long has this been on? Warriors Educate.
Warriors Educate About Rescue. Where? It's shortened for where. We are a 501c3 nonprofit. We're new to the nonprofit world. We're doing We support rescue. We're not actually a rescue ourselves. We support rescue. I've been in rescue for a long time. We started going into the schools to educate about rescue and homeless dogs. And then also companion animals, feral cats, community cats, TNR. Just to support the rescue community, our focus is on education, spay and neuter, and sponsorship vetting for the rescues in need. So we have gone to 6 elementary schools now this year and taught our classes and seminars. We always bring a pet with us. I'm going to be tagging Zippy. Now he's going to have to go. And then it also helps the kids to understand how to interact themselves and how to be a better pet owner for them and their parents.
How to meet a dog.
I'm assuming we'll be on the learning channel in the near future.
Yes, we're going to be. It's happening tomorrow.
That's
our own show.
That.
It screams. We're going to be out there. What I really want to stress is the state of Texas has an overwhelming problem with homeless animals abused and abandoned. And in my state, my beloved state, I don't believe we are going to be able to rescue our way out of that. Yeah. I started where for Warriors Educate About Rescue to change the educational aspect. I do believe that we can change the future because of education.
Okay. We're going to have to end with that. Lou, thank you so much. That was Lou Robinson.
Oh, I love y'all having me.
Hightower. Yeah. Well, we love having you. You're very demonstrative and you help a bunch. Lisa, you are an absolute doll. Ladies and gentlemen, April 4th, 5 o'clock to register, 6 o'clock just to come and watch. It's a hoot. You're hanging with the haters. His time has just now ended. We'll be on Facebook. We'll be on YouTube and iTunes and all over the world. Thank you all so much for listening. Thank our guests.
Thank you.
Next time.
Thanks for checking out this recording from Lone Star Community Radio. Lone Star Community Radio is Montgomery County's community radio station. Broadcasted live from Conroe, Texas on IRLoneStar.com and Conroe's FM 104.5, 106.1. Interested in sponsoring this show, being a guest, hosting your own show, and please visit us online at irlonestar.com and check out the Contact Us page. We want to say thank you to our studio supporters, our traffic sponsor, Conroe Americana Music Festival at conroeamericanamusicfestival.com. For more information about the show, please check out the information below in the description.